Note: these few paragraphs are nearly an autobiography of the life of Charles Dudley Warner, whose contributions to the story start here with Chapter 12. D. W. His pen, therefore, and whereas, and not as aforesaid, strayed off into other scribbling. In an unfortunate hour he had two or three papers accepted by first-class magazines, at $3 the printed page, and behold, his vocation was open to him. He would make his mark in literature. Life has no moment so sweet as that in which a young man believes himself called into the immortal ranks of the masters of literature. It is such a noble ambition that it is a pity it has usually such a shallow foundation. At the time of this history, Philip had gone to New York for a career. With his talent, he thought he should have little difficulty in getting an editorial position upon a metropolitan newspaper. Not that he knew anything about newspaper work, or had the least idea of journalism. He knew he was not fitted for the technicalities of the subordinate departments, but he could write leaders with perfect ease, he was sure. The drudgery of the newspaper office was too distasteful, and, besides, it would be beneath the dignity of a graduate and a successful magazine writer. He wanted to begin at the top of the ladder. To his surprise, he found that every situation in the editorial department of the journals was full, always had been full, was always likely to be full. It seemed to him that the newspaper managers didn't want genius, but mere plodding and grubbing. Philip, therefore, read diligently in the Astor Library, planned literary works that should compel attention, and nursed his genius. He had no friend wise enough to tell him to step into the Dorking Convention, then in session, make a sketch of the men and women on the platform, and take it to the editor of the Daily Grapevine, and see what he could get a line for it. One day he had an offer from some country friends, who believed in him, to take charge of a provincial daily newspaper, and he went to consult Mr. Gringo, who years ago managed the Atlas, about taking the situation.
"Take it, of course," says Gringo. "Take anything that offers. Why not?"
"But they want me to make it an opposition paper."
"Well, make it that. That party is going to succeed. It's going to elect the next president."
"But I don't believe it," said Philip stoutly. "It's wrong in principle, and it ought not to succeed. But I don't see how I can go for a thing I don't believe in."
"Oh, very well," said Gringo, turning away with a shade of contempt. "You'll find, if you are going into literature and newspaper work, that you can't afford a conscience like that."
But Philip did afford it, and he wrote, thanking his friends, and declining because he said the political scheme would fail, and ought to fail. And he went back to his books, and to his waiting for an opening large enough for his dignified entrance into the literary world. It was in this time of rather impatient waiting that Philip was one morning walking down Broadway with Henry Brierly. He frequently accompanied Henry partway downtown to what the latter called his office in Broad Street, to which he went, or pretended to go, with regularity every day. It was evident to the most casual acquaintance that he was a man of affairs, and that his time was engrossed with the largest sort of operations, about which there was a mysterious air. His liability to be suddenly summoned to Washington, or Boston, or Montreal, or even to Liverpool, was always imminent. He never was so summoned, but none of his acquaintances would have been surprised to hear any day that he had gone to Panama or Peoria, or to hear from him that he had bought the Bank of Commerce.